This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, Alice of Old Vincennes by Maurice Thompson. Preface. To M. Placide Valcour, M. D. Ph.D. LL. D. My dear Dr. Valcour, you gave me the inspiration which made this story haunt me until I wrote it. Gaspard Roussillon's letter, a mildewed relic of the year 1788, which you so kindly permitted me to copy as far as it remained legible, was the point from which my imagination, accompanied by my curiosity, set out upon a long and delightful quest. You laughed at me when I became enthusiastic regarding the possible historical importance at that ancient find, alas, fragmentary epistle. But the old saying about the beatitude of him whose cachinnations are latest comes handy to me just now, and I must remind you that I told you so. True enough, it was history pure and simple that I had in mind while enjoying the large hospitality of your Gulfside home. Gaspard Roussillon's letter then appealed to my greed for materials which would help along the making of my little book, The Story of Louisiana. Later, however, as my frequent calls upon you for both documents and suggestions have informed you, I fell to strumming a different guitar. And now to you I dedicate this historical romance of Old Vincennes as a very appropriate, however slight, recognition of your scholarly attainments, your distinguished career in a noble profession, and your descent from one of the earliest French families, if not the very earliest, long resident at that strange little post on the Wabash, now one of the most beautiful cities between the Great River and the ocean. Following, with ever-tantalized expectancy, the broken and breezy hints in the Roussillon letter, I pursued a will-o'-the-wisp here, there, yonder, until by slowly arriving increments, I gathered up a large amount of valuable facts, which when I came to compare them with the history of Clark's conquest of the Wabash Valley, fitted amazingly well into certain spaces heretofore left open in that important yet sadly imperfect record. You will find that I was not so wrong in suspecting that Emile Jason, mentioned in the Roussillon letter, was a brother of Jean Jason and a famous scout in the time of Boone and Clark. He was, therefore, a kinsman of yours on the maternal side, and I congratulate you. Another thing may please you, the success which attended my long and patient research with a view to clearing up the connection between Alice Roussillon's romantic life, as brokenly sketched in M. Roussillon's letter, and the capture of Vincennes by Colonel George Rogers Clark. Except, then, this book, which to those who care only for history will seem but an idle romance, while to the lovers of romance it may look strangely like the mustiest history. In my mind, and in yours, I hope, it will always be connected with a breezy summer house on a headland of the Louisiana Gulf Coast, the rustling of palmetto leaves, the fine flash of roses, a tumult of mockingbird voices, the soft lilt of Creole patois, and the endless dash and roar of a fragrant sea over which the gulls and pelicans never ceased their flight, and beside which you smoked while I dreamed. Maurice Thompson, July 1900. End of Preface. Chapter 1, Under the Cherry Tree. Up to the days of Indiana's early statehood, probably as late as 1825, there stood, in what is now the beautiful little city of Vincennes on the Wabash, the decaying remnant of an old and curiously gnarled cherry tree known as the Roussillon tree, La Cerise de Monsieur Roussillon, as the French inhabitants called it, which as long as it lived bore fruit remarkable for richness of flavor and peculiar dark ruby depth of color. the exact spot where this noble old seedling from La Belle France flourished, declined, and died cannot be certainly pointed out, for in the rapid and happy growth of Vincennes many landmarks once notable, among them Le Cerisier de Monsieur Roussillon, have been destroyed, and the spots where they stood, once familiar to every eye in old Vincennes, are now lost in the pleasant confusion of the new town. The security of certain land titles may have largely depended upon the disappearance of old, fixed objects here and there. Early records were loosely kept, indeed, scarcely kept at all. Many were destroyed by designing land speculators, while those most carefully preserved often failed to give even a shadowy trace of the actual boundaries of the estates held thereby, so that the position of a house or tree not infrequently settled an important question of property rights left open by a primitive deed. At all events, the Roussillon cherry tree disappeared long ago, nobody living knows how, and with it also vanished, quite as mysteriously, all traces of the once important Roussillon estate. Not a record of the name even can be found, it is said, in church or county books. The old, twisted, gum-embossed cherry tree survived every other distinguishing feature of what was once the most picturesque and romantic place in Vincennes. Just north of it stood, in the early French days, a low, rambling cabin surrounded by rude verandas overgrown with grapevines. This was the Roussillon place, the most pretentious home in all the Wabash country. Its owner was Gaspard Roussillon, a successful trader with the Indians. He was rich, for the time and the place, influential to a degree, a man of some education, who had brought with him to the wilderness a bundle of books and a taste for reading. From faded letters and dimly remembered talk of those who once clung fondly to the legends and traditions of old Vincennes, it is drawn that the Roussillon cherry tree stood not very far away from the present site of the Catholic Church, on a slight swell of ground overlooking a wide marshy flat and the silver current of the Wabash. If the tree grew there, then there too stood the Roussillon house with its cozy log rooms, its clay-daub chimneys, and its grapevine-mantled verandas, while some distance away and nearer the river, the rude fort with its huddled offices quarters seemed to fling out over the wild landscape through its squinting and lopsided portholes, a gaze of stubborn defiance. Not far off was the little log church, where one good Father Beret, or as named by the Indians, who all loved him, Father Blackrobe, performed the services of his sacred calling, and scattered all around were the cabins of traders, soldiers, and woodsmen, forming a queer little town, the like of which cannot now be seen anywhere on the earth. It is not known just when Vincennes was first founded, but most historians make the probable date very early in the 18th century, somewhere between 1710 and 1730. In 1810, the Roussillon cherry tree was thought by a distinguished botanical letter writer to be at least 50 years old, which would make the date of its planting about 1760. Certainly, as shown by the time-stained family records upon which this story of ours is based, it was a flourishing and wide-topped tree in early summer of 1778, its branches loaded to drooping with luscious fruit. So low did the dark red clusters hang at one point that a tall young girl standing on the ground easily reached the best ones and made her lips purple with their juice while she ate them. That was long ago, measured by what has come to pass on the gentle swell of rich country from which Vincennes overlooks the Wabash. The new town flourishes notably, and its appearance marks the latest limit of progress. Electric cars in its streets, electric lights in its beautiful homes, the roar of railway trains coming and going in all directions, bicycles whirling hither and thither, the most fashionable styles of equipages, from brougham to pony phaeton, make the days of flintlock guns and buckskin trousers seem ages down the past. And yet we are looking back over but a little more than 120 years to see Alice Roussillon standing under the cherry tree and holding high a tempting cluster of fruit, while a very short, hump-backed youth looks up with longing eyes and vainly reaches for it. The tableau is not merely rustic, it is primitive. Jump, the girl is saying in French, jump, Jean, jump high. Yes, that was very long ago, in the days when women lightly braved what the strongest men would shrink from now. Alice Roussillon was tall, lithe, strongly knit, with an almost perfect figure, judging by what the master sculptors carved for the form of Venus, and her face was comely and winning, if not absolutely beautiful. But the time and the place were vigorously indicated by her dress, which was of coarse stuff and simply designed. Plainly she was a child of the American wilderness, a daughter of old Vincennes on the Wabash in the time that tried men's souls. "Jump, Jean," she cried, her face laughing with a show of cheek dimples, an arching of finely sketched brows, and the twinkling of large blue-gray eyes. "Jump high and get them." While she waved her sun-browned hand holding the cherries aloft, the breeze blowing fresh from the southwest tossed her hair so that some loose strands shone like rimpled flames. The sturdy little hunchback did leap with surprising activity, but the treacherous brown hand went higher, so high that the combined altitude of his jump and the reach of his unnaturally long arms was overcome. Again and again he sprang vainly into the air comically, like a long-legged, squat-bodied frog. "And you brag of your agility and strength, Jean," she laughingly remarked. "But you can't take cherries when they are offered to you. What a clumsy bungler you are." "I can climb and get some," he said with a hideously happy grin, and immediately embraced the bole of the tree, up which he began scrambling almost as fast as a squirrel. When he had mounted high enough to be extending a hand for a hold on a crotch, Alice grasped his leg near the foot and pulled him down, despite his clinging and struggling, until his hands clawed in the soft earth at the tree's root, while she held his captive leg almost vertically erect. It was a show of great strength, but Alice looked quite unconscious of it, laughing merrily, the dimples deepening in her plump cheeks, her forearm, now bared to the elbow, gleaming white and shapely while its muscles rippled on account of the jerking and kicking of Jean. All the time she was holding the cherries high in her other hand, shaking them by the twig to which their slender stems attached them, and saying in a sweetly tantalizing tone, "What makes you climb downward after cherries? Jean, what a foolish fellow you are, indeed, trying to grabble cherries out of the ground, as you do potatoes. I'm sure I didn't suppose that you knew so little as that." Her French was colloquial, but quite good, showing here and there what we often notice in the speech of those who have been educated in isolated places far from that babble of polite energies which we call the world. Something that may be described as a bookish cast, appearing oddly in the midst of phrasing distinctly rustic and local, a peculiarity not easy to transfer from one language to another. Jean the Hunchback was a muscular little deformity and a wonder of good nature. His head looked unnaturally large, nestling grotesquely between the points of his lifted and distorted shoulders, like a shaggy black animal in the fork of a broken tree. He was bellicose in his amiable way, and never knew just when to acknowledge defeat. How long he might have kept up the hopeless struggle with the girl's invincible grip would be hard to guess. His release was caused by the approach of a third person, who wore the robe of a Catholic priest and the countenance of a man who had lived and suffered a long time without much loss of physical strength and endurance. This was Per Beret, grizzly short, compact, his face deeply lined, his mouth decidedly aslant on account of some lost teeth, and his eyes set deep under gray, shaggy brows. Looking at him when his features were in repose, a first impression might not have been favorable, but seeing him smile or hearing him speak changed everything. His voice was sweetness itself, and his smile won you on the instant. Something like a pervading sorrow always seemed to be close behind his eyes and under his speech, yet he was a genial, sometimes almost jolly man, very prone to join in the lighter amusements of his people. "Children, children, my children," he called out as he approached along a little pathway leading up from the direction of the church. "What are you doing now? Bother, Alice, will you pull Jean's leg off?" At first, they did not hear him. They were so nearly deafened by their own vocal discords. "Why are you standing on your head with your feet so high in air, Jean?" he added. "It's not a polite attitude, in the presence of a young lady. Are you a pig, that you poke your nose in the dirt?" Alice now turned her bright head and gave Perberet a look of frank welcome, which at the same time shot a beam of willful self-assertion. "My daughter, are you trying to help Jean up the tree feet foremost?" the priest added, standing where he had halted just outside of the straggling yard fence. He had his hands on his hips and was quietly chuckling at the scene before him, as one who, although old, sympathized with the natural and harmless sportiveness of young people and would as lief as not join in a prank or two. "You see what I'm doing, Father Beret," said Alice. "I am preventing a great damage to you. You will maybe lose a good many cherry pies and dumplings if I let Jean go. He was climbing the tree to pilfer the fruit, so I pulled him down, you understand." "Ta, ta," exclaimed the good man, shaking his gray head. "We must reason with the child. Let go his leg, daughter, I will vouch for him, eh, Jean?" Alice released the hunchback, then laughed gaily and tossed the cluster of cherries into his hand, whereupon he began munching them voraciously and talking at the same time. "I knew I could get them," he boasted, "and see, I have them now." He hopped around, looking like a species of ill-formed monkey. Perberet came and leaned on the low fence close to Alice. She was almost as tall as he. "The sun scorches today," he said, beginning to mop his furrowed face with a red-flowered cotton handkerchief. "And from the look of the sky yonder," pointing southward, "it is going to bring on a storm. How is Madame Roussillon today?" "She is complaining, as she usually does when she feels extremely well," said Alice. "That's why I had to take her place at the oven and bake pies. I got hot and came out to catch a bit of this breeze." "Oh, but you needn't smile and look greedy, Perberet. The pies are not for your teeth." "My daughter, I am not a glutton, I hope. I had meat not 2 hours since, some broiled young squirrels with cress sent me by René de Ronville. He never forgets his old father." "Oh, I never forget you either, mon père. I thought of you today every time I spread a crust and filled it with cherries, and when I took out a pie all brown and hot, the red juice bubbling out of it so good smelling and tempting. Do you know what I said to myself? How could I know, my child? Well, I thought this, not a single bite of that pie does Father Beret get." "Why so, daughter?" "Because you said it was bad of me to read novels, and told Mother Roussillon to hide them from me. I've had any amount of trouble about it." "Ta, ta, read the good books that I gave you. They will soon kill the taste for these silly romances." "I tried," said Alice. "I tried very hard, and it's no use. Your books are dull and stupidly heavy. What do I care about something that a queer lot of saints did, hundreds of years ago, in times of plague and famine? Saints must have been pokey people, and it is pokey people who care to read about them, I think. I like reading about brave, heroic men and beautiful women, and war and love. Perberet looked away with a curious expression in his face, his eyes half closed. "And I'll tell you now, Father Beret," Alice went on after a pause, "no more claret and pies do you get until I can have my own sort of books back again to read as I please." She stamped her moccasin-shod foot with decided energy. The good priest broke into a hearty laugh, and taking off his cap of grass straw mechanically scratched his bald head. He looked at the tall, strong girl before him for a moment or two, and it would have been hard for the best physiognomist to decide just how much of approval and how much of disapproval that look really signified. Although, as Father Beret had said, the sun's heat was violent, causing that gentle soul to pass his bundled handkerchief with a wiping circular motion over his bald and bedewed pate, the wind was momently freshening, while up from behind the trees on the horizon beyond the river, a cloud was rising blue-black, tumbled, and grim against the sky. "Well," said the priest, evidently trying hard to exchange his laugh for a look of regretful resignation, "you will have your own way, my child, and then you will have pies galore and no end of claret," she interrupted, at the same time stepping to the withtied and peg-latched gate of the yard and opening it. "Come in, you dear, good father, before the rain shall begin, and sit with me on the gallery, the Creole word for veranda, till the storm is over." Father Beret seemed not loath to enter, albeit he offered a weak protest against delaying some task he had in hand. Alice reached forth and pulled him in, then reclosed the queer little gate and pegged it. She caressingly passed her arm through his and looked into his weather-stained old face with childlike affection. There was not a photographer's camera to be had in those days, but what if a tourist with one in hand could have been there to take a snapshot at the priest and the maiden as they walked arm in arm to that squat little veranda? The picture today would be worth its weight in a first water diamond. It would include the cabin, the cherry tree, a glimpse of the raw, wild background, and a sharp portrait group of Perberet, Alice, and Jean the Hunchback. To compare it with a photograph of the same spot now would give a perfect impression of the historic atmosphere, color, and conditions which cannot be set in words. But we must not belittle the power of verbal description. What if a thoroughly trained newspaper reporter had been given the freedom of old Vincennes on the Wabash during the first week of June 1778, and we now had his printed story? What a supplement to the photographer's pictures. Well, we have neither photographs nor graphic report, yet there they are before us, the gowned and straw-capped priest, the fresh-faced, coarsely clad and vigorous girl, the grotesque little hunchback, all just as real as life itself. Each of us can see them, even with closed eyes. Led by that wonderful guide, imagination, we step back a century and more to look over a scene at once strangely attractive and unspeakably forlorn. What was it that drew people away from the old countries, from the cities, the villages and the vineyards of beautiful France, for example, to dwell in the wilderness, amid wild beasts and wilder savage Indians, with a rude cabin for a home, and the exposures and hardships of pioneer life for their daily experience? Men like Gaspard Roussillon are of a distinct stamp. Take him as he was. Born in France, on the banks of the Rhone near Avignon, he came as a youth to Canada, whence he drifted on the tide of adventure this way and that, until at last he found himself with a wife at Post Vincennes, that lonely picket of religion and trade, which was to become the center of civilizing energy for the great Northwestern Territory. M. Roussillon had no children of his own, so his kind heart opened freely to two fatherless and motherless waifs. These were Alice, now called Alice Roussillon, and the hunchback Jean. The former was 12 years old when he adopted her, a child of Protestant parents, while Jean had been taken, when a mere babe, after his parents had been killed and scalped by Indians. Madame Roussillon, a professed invalid, whose appetite never failed, and whose motherly kindness expressed itself most often through strains of monotonous falsetto scolding, was a woman of little education and no refinement, while her husband clung tenaciously to his love of books, especially to the romances most in vogue when he took leave of France. M. Roussillon had been, in a way, Alice's teacher, though not greatly inclined to abet Father Beret in his kindly efforts to make a Catholic of the girl, and most treacherously disposed toward the good priest in the matter of his well-meant attempts to prevent her from reading and rereading the aforesaid romances. But for many weeks past, Gaspard Roussillon had been absent from home, looking after his trading schemes with the Indians, and Père Beret, acting on the suggestion of the proverb about the absent cat and the playing mouse, had formed an alliance offensive and defensive with Madame Roussillon, in which it was strictly stipulated that all novels and romances were to be forcibly taken and securely hidden away from Mademoiselle Alice, which, to the best of Madame Roussillon's ability, had accordingly been done. Now, while the wind strengthened, and the softly booming summer shower came on apace, the heavy cloud lifting as it advanced and showing under it the dark gray sheet of the rain, Père Beret and Alice sat under the clapboard roof behind the vines of the veranda and discussed what was generally uppermost in the priest's mind upon such occasions, the good of Alice's immortal soul, a subject not absorbingly interesting to her at any time. It was a standing grief to the good old priest, this strange perversity of the girl in the matter of religious duty, as he saw it. True, she had a faithful guardian in Gaspard Roussillon, but, much as he had done to aid the church's work in general, for he was always vigorous and liberal, he could not be looked upon as a very good Catholic, and of course his influence was not effective in the right direction. But then Père Beret saw no reason why, in due time and with patient work, aided by Madame Roussillon and notwithstanding Gaspard's treachery, he might not safely lead Alice, whom he loved as a dear child, into the arms of the Holy Church, to serve which faithfully, at all hazards and in all places, was his highest aim. "Ah, my child," he was saying, "you are a sweet, good girl, after all, much better than you make yourself out to be. Your duty will control you, you do it nobly at last, my child." "True enough, Father Beret, true enough," she responded, laughing. "Your perception is most excellent, which I will prove to you immediately." She rose while speaking and went into the house. "I'll return in a minute or two," she called back from a region which Père Beret well knew was that of the pantry. "Don't get impatient and go away." Père Beret laughed softly at the preposterous suggestion that he would even dream of going out in the rain, which was now roaring heavily on the loose board roof, and miss a cut of cherry pie, a cherry pie of Alice's making. And the Roussillon claret, too, was always excellent. "Ah, child," he thought, "your old father is not going away." She presently returned, bearing on a wooden tray a ruby-stained pie and a short stout bottle flanked by two glasses. "Of course I'm better than I sometimes appear to be," she said, almost humbly, but with mischief still in her voice and eyes, "and I shall get to be very good when I have grown old. The sweetness of my present nature is in this pie." She set the tray on a three-legged stool, which she pushed close to him. "There now," she said, "let the rain come, you'll be happy, rain or shine, while the pie and wine last, I'll be bound." Père Beret fell to eating right heartily, meantime handing Jean a liberal piece of the luscious pie. "It is good, my daughter, very good indeed," the priest remarked with his mouth full. Madame Roussillon has not neglected your culinary education. Alice filled a glass for him. It was Bordeaux and very fragrant. The bouquet reminded him of his sunny boyhood in France, of his journey up to Paris, and of his careless, joy-brimmed youth in the gay city. How far away, how misty, yet how thrillingly sweet it all was.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.